Hi everybody, there's a hornbill there, you can see. I'm just trying to sneak closer, eating a fruit chaffer, the most beautiful green beetle. Ooh. I'll try and get a little bit closer to him, but it is the most stunning colour. I'll show you a picture of it. Didn't like us having a look at him. Ooh, he keeps dropping it. Don't be afraid, hornbill. Yeah, we'll stop here. There you can get an idea of the colour. I'll try and find your picture while we watch him there. And what he's doing is breaking up the exoskeleton. So that's why he hasn't swallowed it straight away. The exoskeleton is hard, very difficult to kind of digest. There we go. He's one of these chaps here. He's one of those things, I think. A regal fruit chaffer. Quite a large beetle with green on his back and not always that much white. Beautiful, beautiful beetle, but unfortunately meeting his end. He could have also been one of those emerald fruit chaffers, but he had a little bit of white on him. Beautiful. Wow. Very nice. We'll just go around the corner and see if we can't see him again. And then what I'm going to do is probably try and get a picture of those lilac-breasted roller chicks who were just near that nest that Scott found the other day. And I'll show that to you after a while. There he is. And you can hear him. If you listen carefully, you might be able to hear him going tick, 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 tick. You forget, you know, how important your teeth are. No, birds don't have teeth, of course, and they can't chew. So if there is anything hard in what they eat, and you see this often with birds that eat fish, they'll hammer away at them like this to kind of crush the bones up so that they don't have to try and digest them. And the keratin in the exoskeleton of that beetle will be almost totally indigestible to that hornbill. So he has to break it up into small pieces before he swallows the beetle. Right, Mike, Karen and Lynn, you have all heard the woodland kingfisher today at the Djuma Dam. I am going to go from this very position. I'm going to scrap the lilac-breasted roller chicks for the moment and head off to Djuma Dam and see if we can't get a view of that woodland kingfisher. I will be most excited to see him. Right, let's leave the fruit chaffer. We're not too far from Djuma Dam now. That fruit chaffer has seen better days, and indeed this will be his last day. Let's go and see if we can find the woodland kingfisher. So we've had multiple confirmed reports. I would have thought this was very late for them to come back. I don't remember them ever coming back this late before. They may have been further north in the Mapani felt, where there are a greater number of holes in the trees which they like to breed in. Quite late for them, I would have thought. Maybe not. Maybe my memory just fails me. Please keep an eye on the Djuma Dam cam. And those of you who don't know, a woodland kingfisher, I think, is one of the most in blue color on them. There are 1, 2, 3, 4 species of them that we get here. And I think this is the most magnificent. He's got the most blue on him. Very beautiful and very distinctive. Totally unmistakable. So if you're not familiar with him, flick onto the Djuma Dam cam maybe and see if he doesn't call again, and then tell me if you can. And I think it's going to be very difficult for you to direct me with sound, but let's see if we can't get a view of the magnificent woodland kingfisher. apparently guessed that today would be the day on the 16th of November that we'd see the woodland kingfisher. Mike, I'm most impressed. Well done. Today is indeed the 16th of November. I'm not sure if it's, is it in, would it be the 16th in Florida yet? Another question from Vernie. Vernie, I might need to just point you towards a book for you to have a look at this, but it's a wonderful question. You want to know about the different flying styles. Why do birds fly in different ways? Why is it that a hornbill will flap a few times and then glide down, flap a few times and glide down, whereas doves will fly in a continuous manner, and eagles and vultures will soar, and why the different strategies? Vernie, it's normally got to do with, it's a complex subject that I will probably not do justice to, but I'll give you an idea. It's got to do with energy balance, and it's got to do with hunting strategy, and it's also got to do with the structure of the bird. And if you look at something like an eagle or a vulture, they need to soar because they need to get high so that they can see what they're going to prey on or scavenge off, and then they will dive down if they're an eagle and try and catch whatever it is. But it's inefficient for a heavy bird like that to try and flap around the whole time. They need to use the air and the thermals in order to get an idea of where their prey is and to stay in the air for a long time. So that's why they soar. Energy balance, and also for the eagles and the birds that actually catch things, it gives them the advantage of being able to come from a great height and dive onto whatever they're going to do. I mean, there's a hornbill flying there, and you'll see exactly what Vernie means. Flap, 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 glide. Flap, 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 glide. Vernie, I think that's just a very efficient way of moving around. They don't use a lot of energy when they do it, and you'll find that something like a dove, the humble dove, is enormously fast, and they need to be enormously fast because they do fall prey quite often at waterholes to falcons and other birds of prey, and they need to be able to get to the ground fast and go at a great speed, and that they're able to do with their flying strategy. So, there's a basic idea of the birds you asked. Of course, then there are the hovering birds, like a black-shouldered kite, which is able to hover in the air, and he can see, that's combined with his ability to see ultraviolet radiation that comes off the uric acid trails left by rats and mice that he likes to eat. Then you get the hovering and the hummingbirds, and that's a tremendously complicated figure-of-eight movement that the wings make and allow them to hover in one place very accurately while they pull the nectar out of plants. So, Bernie, lots of different reasons for the different flight patterns. Mainly to do with energy balance and prey, catching prey species. Right, there is a hippopotamus in front of us, and I'm going to stop here and turn off and see if we can't hear the woodland kingfisher. Right. Let's have a listen. Now, we're looking at a pan full of water and a hippopotamus, which is not the ideal habitat for that fellow, because obviously he can't fit a girlfriend into that pan and keep her satisfied in the manner to which she would have become accustomed in her father's pod in a large dam or river. And while we're looking at that pan is pumped, of course, the dam behind it is not. And Jeffrey in Texas, you want to know how much water it would take into that dam behind us there for the catfish to come out of what you've termed hibernation. Jeffrey, quite a lot more than we've had. They will need standing water for them to come out of their state of, it's not hibernation, it's something called aestivation. which is a very similar state, but it's the word that we use to describe animals that are in that kind of dormant state as a result of dry, not cold. So hibernating animals tend to go into that dormant state because of the cold, and estivating animals do it because it gets very dry. So those estivating catfish will be under the mud there until there is some decent standing water for them to come out into. And who knows when that will be. Now, we were watching that hornbill breaking up the exoskeleton of the fruits chaffer that it was devouring, and Anna Marie, you've asked a question about what bird is it that will smash its prey against the branch in order to break it up. Anna Marie, there are various birds that will do that. I've seen kingfishers doing it with fish to break up the bones. They'll smash them against the branches like that to break up the bones, and then they swallow the fish. I've seen hornbills doing it with beetles, just like that. So there are lots and lots of different birds that will do it. It's mainly the insect eaters. They pick up a big insect, or the fish eaters. Those fish eaters, remember, for many of them, small birds, and they need to break up the fish a bit, and maybe also descale it. I think you'll find a lot of the kingfishers do it to get the scales off the bird, off the fish before they swallow it. They don't seem to have the same ability as, say, the storks. There's a hardy-dar ibis coming in. I thought it was an enormous bird of prey. It's actually just a really terrified hardy-dar. So unlike the storks, which are just able to pick out bits of huge fish on their own and then swallow them, as long as they can get them through the throat, they don't seem to make any effort at all to break up the bones. But there are lots of them, Anna Marie, that will break up either the exoskeleton or the bones of their prey by smashing them against the branches. They also, the other reason they do it, of course, is I've seen it done with frogs, and that will be to get the, first of all, to smash it up, and also to sometimes the frogs and the toads have got toxins in the skin, and by slapping them against the trees and the branches, those toxins will eventually come out, which will make eating a lot more delicious. Now, I cannot hear a woodland kingfisher at the moment, so I'm going to drive gently around this area and see if we can't spot him. Hence, bright blue is what we're looking for. While we're driving around looking for this woodland kingfisher, Rich King, you've asked if there's ever been a situation where an unusual relationship between birds has been set up. Now, of course, unusual is quite a euphemistic word. So between species, say between a dove and a hornbill, they have fallen in love and tried to produce hybrid horn doves. No, Rich, that hasn't happened, and I'll tell you why it hasn't. When you look at birds, we tend to forget the fact that they are often far more distantly related than some of the mammals we see. So, the difference between a hornbill and a dove is the same as the difference between a dog and a monkey. So you wouldn't ever find them setting up and trying to mate with each other because they're just so far unrelated. So closer related birds, like say the two kingfishers, say a woodland kingfisher and a brown-hooded kingfisher, they come from the same genus. They, in theory, could possibly try and hybridize. I'm not sure if it's ever happened before. I seriously doubt it, but it's not impossible. And that would be the same as a lion and a tiger setting up shop together. And that has happened once or twice in captivity. There are rumors that it's happened in the wild. I'm not convinced myself. But that they very closely related animals. A bit like a horse and a donkey can produce a mule, they're very closely related genetically. Whereas a hornbill and a dove are as far distantly related to each other as we are from a cat, say. Interesting one. Thank you for that, Rich. And we tend to think of birds as being very closely related, especially if we're not kind of biologically minded, simply because they all fly and they look relatively similar, a kind of structure to them. They look more similar. Hornbill and a dove looks much more similar than, say, a monkey and a honey badger. Alright, let's head across to Scott's, get an update with Karula. We'll keep looking around here and see if we can't find that recalcitrant woodland kingfisher. Oh no, bad news. Bad news, everyone. Before we go across to Scott, just as Kebs, can you see the squirrel in there? You see that squirrel there?
Got it there?
There's a squirrel on this tree. Come to the right of where you are there. Right, sorry, left of where you are. There. Just zoom in straight there. You'll get him. Up a bit. Up a bit. There. That's him there. Now, that squirrel has just come out of the hole in which I planted my leopard orchid. So I suspect my leopard orchid has bit the dust, and I think that's a junior squirrel, I think that's a baby. So I will have to have a look. Okay, not a major tragedy, everybody. We'll get over it eventually. So let's head across to Scott and I'll mourn the loss of my leopard orchid. See you just now.
Well, terrible, terrible news. Poor old James and his leopard orchid.
Vim and I were wondering what on earth could be this bad news that James was about to reveal. And thankfully it wasn't as bad as a lot of us were probably expecting it to be. He is a joker, old James, and he certainly keeps us entertained at the camp, as I'm sure he does keep you guys entertained whilst on safari. You would have seen that Karula is now flat, fast asleep. She's stopped grooming herself, and likelihood of her going and feeding on this kill in the short future is not promising. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a loop around, see what else we can find, possibly something interesting like the sighting you had with James now with the hornbill and that Schaefer beetle. Sounds awesome. Looking forward to the highlights of that. But that is a perfect example of what we could stumble upon, or something else of a similar nature. So let's move off. I have made sure that Andrew knows that we are very interested in returning here if she does show any signs of life, and he'll call us over the radio if that does in fact happen. But for now, you can see, not looking promising. So we'll just do one loop around. We'll always be 2 minutes away in case something does happen. Let's just increase our chances of seeing what else is going on. Cheers, guys, enjoy. So some Impala birth guesses have come through already. Lucy is guessing, I think, the 18th. Edward and Lynn think the 19th. Anna Marie and Donna on the 21st, it sounds like. So thank you very much for sending through your guesses. Keep them written down somewhere, and that way we'll have some evidence and just a way of keeping track of whose guesses were in, because it'll be very difficult, obviously, to remember everyone's. My guess was the 22nd of November. So really looking forward to seeing those cute baby impala running around, along with a lot of other small herbivores that we will be seeing in the coming months. Not all of them will be born strictly over this period. Animals like buffalo and elephants and giraffe, the animals with longer gestation periods, don't necessarily always give birth in the summer months. They can give birth throughout the year.
Hello again to Nkunj, one of our new viewers. And Nkunj noticed Karula's tail flicking from side to side and would like to know what exactly we can read into that in terms of their behavior. Why do they do it? A good question, Nkunj, and a very difficult one to answer precisely. But basically, it's an indicator of emotion or excitement, similar to a dog, I guess. When a dog is excited, it wags its tail. When a leopard's excited or anticipating some kind of action, that tail will twitch from side to side. Often when they're hunting or when they're a little bit nervous, that tail will twitch. But it won't be a certain twitch for a certain signal or certain behavior. It's just kind of general twitching and movements for general excitement or anticipation, I guess. So that's all I can read into the leopard's tail's twitching. Something that we can look forward to seeing, Nkunj, is this specific female leopard and others holding her tail up high and almost dangling it back over her head while she walks. I'll point it out when she does it. Not easy for me to reenact while sitting here in the vehicle. Hello, Zebbies. They are such wonderful animals, and I'm glad it didn't take us long to stumble upon some other sights and scenes to share with you. This young foal, interestingly, you can see how it's developing. It's kind of front half is adult and its back half is foal. And by adults I mean short hair, very black in coloration. By foal I mean slightly longer, more fluffy fur and more brown in coloration. So this one is slowly developing into an adult. Yes, you. Good morning. You can see the female at the back right. Look at how much her stomach's protruding. Oh, as I said, that the other one popped into view. And let's see. I know, that must be the stallion. Yeah, that's the stallion. He's certainly not pregnant. And it's the two females at the back are the adults, and it could be their two foals from last year in the foreground. Look at that one at the back now, you can see her big belly as she moves into the opening. As with the other one now, very, very heavily pregnant. So in the coming weeks, guys, we're going to be seeing some tiny zebra foals. I cannot wait. They are one of the cutest of the newborn animals that we are going to be seeing. Let's see if we can get you a few more views. The bush is a little bit thick here, but we'll try and make a plan. I don't think they're going to be hanging around. Off they go. What a great scene. A long line of zebras heading off into the unknown. Thankfully, zebras, there's no lions around that we know of, so you're going to have a stress-free day. No way! Such awesome news has just come through over the radio. James has heard a woodlands kingfisher, finally! And he is now trying to track it down. So exciting prospects. We've been talking about the arrival of the woodlands kingfisher. A lot of you would have put down dates for that. I don't remember if I actually committed to a date, or if I did, I've certainly forgotten what it was. If any of you can remember, please share that with us. But a lot of you would have had guesses as to when the first woodlands kingfisher will be seen, and it could well be this morning. So if today was your day, best you Cross fingers for James. That's great news. They are such pretty birds. And what I'll do is I'll actually get the call out for you and attempt to play it for you, just so you know what sound James has heard. It's a shrill chick. Is my impersonation. But I'm going to use my fancy new bird app to... Oh, no. To get you this call ready. There we go. Chick. Another one. So that's the call that James has heard, and it's a beautiful call of the summer months. Quite similar to their cousin, the grey-headed kingfisher, and the grey-headed kingfisher is really pretty, and its call goes something like this. It's kind of like the end portion of the woodlands kingfisher's call. Similar kind of shrill. And what I must now do is stop that and show you both of those birds. The grey-headed. This picture doesn't do it nearly as much justice as the real thing. Very, very pretty though. I love the dark blue at the base of their wings and tail. So that's the grey-headed kingfisher. Also migratory, also just returned back from central parts of Africa. I've saw two the other day. And this is the woodlands kingfisher here. Again, the picture doesn't do it justice. This blue coloration is more electric turquoise in real life. So that is what James is looking for, and hopefully he will find it. Very, very pretty. And interesting how some of the migratory birds arrived months ago, but others are still only making their way. So I'm not sure if James has updated you on the plans for the morning, but Jamie is going to be doing a drive for some schools. I think here in South Africa, I don't know the finer details, but she's going to be taking over this vehicle at 7:30, so 25 more minutes for me. And she's going to be doing a drive, I think, from 8 until 9:30. So you will be able to tune in for a bit of extra safari action. She will be catering specifically for these school kids, but would love you guys to join in on the adventure with her. So that's good news for all of you, a bit of a surprise addition. But it does mean I've only got 25 minutes more of safari with you. James is busy trying to call this woodlands kingfisher, and he would like you to jump on board with him. Good luck, guys. I hope you find it.
Now, I heard everybody. I did actually hear the woodland kingfisher. So, I do believe all of you now. He was in this tree while I was looking for my leopard orchid, which has been devoured by that beastly squirrel. And what I'm trying to do now is call it with my telephone app that has got the bird call. Now, I've thus far been totally unsuccessful. Right, now, here we shall play the thing again. That's my phone, not the real bird. Alas, this bird is not being... Can't tell whether that was on my phone or if that was live. No response. They are not to be conned, these fellows. Anyway, we'll keep driving around here and we'll see if we can't spot him somewhere along the way. So my poor little leopard orchid, I'm afraid, has been devoured by a squirrel. It is now no more than a husk, and unfortunately we will have to try and plant another one and de-squirrel it. And Anne, as you say, tragic circumstances, leopard killed by squirrel.
Yes, exactly.
I do not know. Where you got this from, which particular part of the world's great superstitions this comes from, but you say the fact that the squirrel has eaten my leopard orchid means another 7 years of a bachelorhood. I suppose it comes from the fact that the leopard orchid can be used as a love potion out here. Lucy, all I can say is one can only hope. 7 more years of bachelorhood, well, probably wouldn't be too bad. Well, we're going to drive slowly down the drainage line. We'll see if we can't pick him up. For those of you perhaps new and haven't heard the story, the reference with the leopard orchid is that if you eat the canes that the leaves grow on, they're kind of succulent, like sort of small sugar canes. That's what they look like. They certainly don't taste like that. But if you suck those on the full moon and say the name of the one you want at midnight, she will immediately start thinking of you. And as I've said before, despite having recited the name of Scarlett Johansson many, many times at midnight while sucking on the disgusting cane of a leopard orchid, she has yet to contact me via Twitter, Facebook, telephone, or any other medium of which I'm aware. Okay, quickly, let's go across the Scott. He's got a snake.
Can you believe it? Look at how pretty this little snake is. It's just swallowed a kill. I'm not sure what it is. Look at how full its throat is. And I'm actually not too sure what snake this is. I'm battling to work out its... throwing me off the fact that it's just swallowed something literally seconds ago. To me it looks like it could be an egg eater, so that could be an egg that it swallowed, but it doesn't make sense. It's not round enough. No, it's certainly not round enough to be an egg. So maybe it's a little mite adder. And this is incredible. We're going to actually be able to monitor whatever it has swallowed slowly moving down its stomach. And we must have just missed that final little portion of the animal that it swallowed by seconds. Now you can see the very distinctive kind of arrows on its head facing forward. That's what indicates to me that it could be either a night adder or an egg eater, but its body shape is leaning towards, for me, more egg eaterish. As opposed to night adderish. The colorations are similar, but egg eaters have got a more slender build than the night adders, which are slightly thicker. Now what I can do is just reposition ever so slightly, because we in identifying snakes, it's very important to just keep on it, please, Ryan. To look at their pupils. Yeah, it's trying to swallow as effectively as possible now. Holding its head up higher. I don't want to frustrate it, because snakes will regurgitate prey in order to lighten their load. As I was saying, that if you can see its pupils, look very closely, and they either have a horizontal pupil or a vertical pupil, or maybe sometimes just a round pupil, and that helps in distinguishing what's what. Look at how beautiful its colorations are. Now, what could happen is that birds could come and mob this little snake. It's vulnerable out in the open here, and I can just hear some lilac-breasted rollers calling around us. Not only will they mob and attack the snake, but the other birds could even catch and kill it. And I've just seen James nearby. I'm going to ask him to come and have a closer look, because he might be able to positively identify this snake correctly. James, do you want to come and have a closer look here? I need a second opinion on the species. Now, what's interesting about how the snake's moving is that it's not really... It is kind of slithering, but you'll see how it's moving in an... I suppose that is a very serpentine action, which also shows us that it's probably an egg eater. Adders will often move in a rectangle, Lisa would like to know if it would have crushed the egg. And yes, Lisa, it would certainly have crushed the egg, but interestingly, it's once the whole egg is inside the mouth of the snake, usually, and then there's kind of two protrusions, tooth-like protrusions at the back of the head, or the back of the mouth, that will puncture that egg as it... And that's why we feed only on eggs, and it may have fed on something else. I'm going to try and reposition again. Again. And thank you very much, Robin in Maryland, for letting us know that you think it is an egg eater, the rhombic egg eater, more specifically. And that is the egg eater that we do get in this area. Look at its little forked tongue there. Getting And we sadly can't get you any closer in with the camera that is on the vehicle. VM's at full zoom. There's some lilac-breasted rollers having an argument around us. Thank you very much for confirming that you think it is the rhombic egg eater. I think you are right. It's a tiny little snake. Just to give you an idea, it's probably only 20 centimeters in length, which is about 7 inches. It really would be wonderful to know what it had swallowed and why it had swallowed it out in the open. That's what I don't understand. The fact that it's not in a likely place to find an egg and swallow it, but it looks like it has very recently swallowed whatever it has. So if anybody could let us know if these egg eaters will feed strictly on eggs, which I don't think is the case. I'm guessing that they may well feed on other animals. As you know, James is here and he's got a much better view of the snake than us, or a different angle at least, so we're going to pop you across onto his vehicle for a slightly different view.
So, very grateful that Scott managed to find me something to look at, which is excellent. Thank you, Scott, for that. I'm in two minds as well. I think it's too skinny to be a night adder. So I would go with egg eater on this. The one very distinguishing mark or part of an egg eater, which I can't get from this angle, is the bluntness of the nose. How blunt its nose is. They should have a pretty blunt nose, as opposed to that kind of... The night adder does have a fairly diamond-shaped head, in my experience.
It looks blunt from here, James.
Okay. And you've confirmed that the adder has a head shaped like a spade, and Scott reckons from his angle that this has got a fairly blunt head. So let's go with egg eater, and as long as we're all in agreement, it doesn't really matter, does it? Yeah, I think he's too skinny to be an adder. Those adders are quite fat little snakes. Don't tend to have that length tail on them either. What a magnificent sighting. Gee whiz. Oh, there you can see him moving now. Sticking his tongue out. And I think that pinkish tinge on his throat is probably also quite distinctive, and possibly a flowing, I don't know, in fact I don't know what it would be. Yeah, I would definitely go with egg eater on this one. It does look very painful to have that stuck in your throat though, doesn't it? That's a really lovely angle. So we're sitting probably about 2.5 meters, so about 10 feet from him. And we don't want to get too much closer because I'm sure Scott's told you he will disgorge that thing onto the ground, whatever it is, and scuttle off. But as Scott says, it's very odd that he or she is sitting there in the middle of the road, totally exposed. I mean, we're a rapturous bird to come past here, or a slender mongoose, I think that snake would be in quite a lot of trouble. And also the temperature won't be helping the snake. Of course, they are ectothermic, which means they're cold-blooded, and that means that they will really struggle on a day like this. They need the ambient temperature to be high for them to function fully. And on a cold day like this, they will struggle to move around a lot. They don't make any heat of their own. And Janine, a very nice question. Are they venomous? They certainly are not poisonous. If you were to eat that snake, you would be perfectly healthy. You would probably be quite happy, actually. But are they venomous? No, an egg eater is not a venomous snake. Now, this is interesting. He's lifting his head up, smelling. That's what that tongue is doing. It's taking little particles of air, pushing them up into a hole in the top of the top palate, which is a channel to a very sensitive organ called the organ of Jacobson. And that will help this little snake interpret what it is that they're looking for. You know what I'm going to do? I'm not going to try and frighten it, but what I'm going to do is I don't think you've got an idea of the size of the snake. I'm going to go and stand next to it, or I'm going to stand behind it. I don't think it will affect the snake. And you can just get an idea of the size. So if you can zoom out a bit, Tebs, yeah, just zoom right out, and I'm just going to walk around quite a long distance away from it, and you'll just get an idea of my feet as they go past it. I'm not going to frighten him at all, but you'll get an idea of the size.
Have you got my feet?
Yeah.
And the snake. So there you can see his size. So he looks probably a bit bigger on screen when you fully zoomed into him than he is in reality.
So he's maybe a foot long. He's maybe just a foot long. Beautiful little snake. Yeah, definitely when I got close like that, on closer inspection, there's no way this is a night adder. I'm sure it's an egg eater. And it looks like, I mean, when you look at him on full zoom and through the binoculars, it looks like he swallowed something the size of a chicken egg. But in fact, it's probably something the size of a very small robin's egg or a weaver's egg. All right, let's head across to Scott. He's going to say goodbye to you. And I will explain what Jamie's going to be doing a little bit later.
Welcome back. We're just getting into position here with Karula again. How awesome was that little snake? And always nice to be able to actually share sightings with the other vehicle. So that was another extra added bonus. And also great for you guys because you get more than one view. Now, we, like I say, have just... She's ready for breakfast yet. I'm guessing this afternoon may be our time then to get lucky, or who knows, maybe with Jamie's extended drive this morning you may get lucky. I'm guessing she will feed during the course of the day, but failing that this evening, I'm confident we will get you some great views of her up in the tree. So if you do have to finish your safari at the regular time this morning, make sure to try and tune in for the sunset safari. There's bound to be some great leopard action, and who knows what else will be happening. As I said earlier, I am going to be finishing the safari a little bit earlier than normal this morning because I need to get Jamie this vehicle, and she's going to be doing an extended drive until 9:30, so an extra hour and a half of drive this morning. It'll just be her out though, so give her some support if you can stay awake, if you're in different time zones to us, or if it suits you and it's early in the morning, well, just enjoy taking more time off work if you are supposed to be working today, I guess. Thank you so much for all your help and contributions to the safari. Well done to VM on camera, to Louise and Nikki in the final control room. We're going to send you back to James, and I look forward to catching up on the sunset safari.
So we're still sitting with this funny little snake, and it is a marvelous little creature, but I think really struggling in this cold weather. I think the temperature with this wind has probably dropped another 4 degrees or so since we began, and I would put the ambient temperature here with this wind at a roughly, I wouldn't say much more than 10 to 14 degrees Celsius, and that will make it very difficult for a snake to move. They have to have heat, and they need the sun in order to fire up their metabolisms and help them to move along. And I think that's why it's moving so incredibly slowly. The next bush where it'll be able to find some shelter, it's really going to take an enormous effort. I'm just calling in, there's another drive coming past us here, and this, they'll be fascinated to know about, to look at this little snake. It's a little snake. Can you see it there? Can you see it?
Yes.
We think it's an egg eater, with a little robin's egg or something stuck in its throat. But I don't think it can move because it's so cold. It's really kind of oozing along the road. All right, everybody, we're gonna head off and have a look at Karula. That's mainly because I haven't seen her today and I feel that you should share her with me. And Tevz also wants to see Karula. Enjoy it. Right. Now, James Bear, you want to know how big the snake is. The snake is just short of a foot, so I'd say roughly that big. Just short of a foot. So not very large at all. And it's an interesting point, because to have found that snake in that slightly odd area, away from any kind of cover, is slightly bizarre. And Brandy, you're suggesting maybe that it was dropped by a bird. I think it's not impossible. I don't think that's a bad idea at all. It could well be that it was dropped there by a bird. It just didn't look very injured. I think it's eaten too much, to be honest, and that it's so cold now, and it's got so much colder during the course of the morning, that it really is going to struggle to get out of there. But it could have been dropped by a bird. Now, we've got to try and find Karula. We know she's in a jackalberry tree around here. And I only know of one or two jackalberries. Oh, I can see the expired antelope hanging in the boughs. Attempts to point the camera at the impala, which is of course is something you'd be looking out for if you were walking. Now you've all seen that today, of course, and that I haven't. And Terry in New Zealand, while we're looking at that, you say you've heard that it's if we touch a snake, they won't mate with each other because there's the scent of the oils on our hands that will leave a residue on the snake's skin. Terry, I think you'll find that if you were to handle a snake quite extensively, yes, that may well have an effect on its ability to mate. It may well, remember, we smell like predators to just about anything out here. So it could well be the case that if you were to touch, say, a snake and then it came across a potential mate, that mate might smell predator on it. And that would definitely be a bad thing for the prospective lovers. But I think that it wouldn't be permanent. I think that, the scent of us would be washed off pretty quickly. Now, if anyone can tell me where the leopard is, that would be marvelous. Oh, Tebs has spotted her. She's nowhere near the kill. Thank you, Tebs. I think as she has been much of the morning, she's been flat on her back. So we'll have a quick look here and guide Jamie in. Hello, Karula. How are you? I think that's where she's been sat for most of the morning, isn't it? She does seem to be getting paler and paler as the days go on. And I strongly suspect that her extensive wanderings over the course of the last week have been because she is in fact looking for a mate again. And I wonder if Tingana has failed to impregnate her yet again. Very lovely. We won't spend too long here. We'll just spend a few minutes here. Enjoy the beauty of the leopard, and then we'll probably have a look at the kill. And then we'll drive around, I think, back to the Djuma Dam and see if we can't start. Now, so Jamie's little show that she's going to be doing, I think, is so exciting. It's just tremendous. There's a school in Johannesburg, a very sort of famous old Johannesburg school called Rodin School for Girls. And my sister went there, actually. And they are, Jamie also went there, and they're grade 1 and grade 2 children, so 7 and 8 year old little girls, are to whom the show is going to be directed. And you are obviously welcome to carry on watching. There will be no change in the actual website, so you just keep watching if you want to watch it, but just bear in mind that it will be directed at very young children. So, very exciting stuff. I think you'll find it tremendously entertaining, and I just think that this kind of thing for schools, and I know that there are a few schools, especially in the States, that watch us during the afternoon drives, and I think it's just a wonderful way to get kids enthralled in the wilderness and in conservation, especially because without children's buy-in, of course, our already threatened wilderness areas will become even more so. All right, let's just do a quick turn around the tree there and have a look. I don't think we need to wait here for Jamie. I think she'll be more than capable of finding this leopard. I don't think she's going anywhere at all. And then we'll press on and let's just see if we can't have one last gander at that woodland kingfisher. Thank you, Julia. In Houston, you say there is an impala fetus in the tree as well. It's a bit grim, but yes, very interesting. And of course, any impala ewe that is killed now will almost inevitably, if she's an adult, she will have the same thing. So not a great beginning to life for this little impala. Now, Annie in British Columbia, you are exactly correct in your guess that, you see it there, Tibbs? You're exactly correct in your guess that leopards will absolutely keep a cache of kills if they can kill more than one. I've seen that with baboons. And you'll see it probably once or twice during the course of the lambing season for the impalas, where the youngsters are so easy to kill, but one or two of them may well end up in a kind of cache. Then that's a fairly grim picture of what's has befallen the impala. And quite typically, the leopard has gone for the backside first. Ah, well. Leopard's got to eat. And there's the fetus. I mean, that could not have been more than a week, maybe two, from full term. Little thing. Let's move on from here and this site of carnage. And we'll go back down towards the Djuma Dam and see if we can't find that woodland kingfisher. And the soil is beautifully wet here now. We had an enormous storm last night, I would say probably about 20 millimeters of rain, so almost an inch, which for us is quite a lot. It may have even been more than that actually, maybe 25, maybe a full inch. And that will have created a beautiful layer, subsurface layer of water for the grasses to start growing out of. And Joel, you were... Before I get on to your question, we did spend some time yesterday digging trenches in our little camp because the water did threaten to inundate us. at various stages, and that dovetails neatly, Joel, with your question about whether or not hyena dens and other dens get flooded. Joel, it's highly unlikely. You know, they're normally in termite mounds. Termite mounds are A, on very well-drained soil, and B, they're normally on sort of slopes. So we'll have a look at this termite mound and I'll show you what I mean. So this termite mound over here, for example, sits on a slope on pretty well drained soils, and I'll tell you what, I'll show you where the den would normally be, and that might help. What you'd have is an aardvark that dug a hole in an area like this, and it's upslope, and so it's highly unlikely that water would ever collect sufficiently to get into a hole that was at my feet here. Likewise, if they dug a hole the other side of the termite mound, the water would just go around it like that. I would say there's the odd chance that it's possible that flooding could take place in a termite mound like that. But I'd say, Joel, it's highly unlikely, especially, certainly not for wild dogs, because they, of course, give birth in the winter time. And unless there was a seriously odd weather pattern that came through, there would be no water at all during the time when the wild dogs give birth. Very chilly out here, I must say. We've just been chatting about that snake and the egg eaters, and Elena, I know someone asked Scott whether egg eaters only eat eggs, and Elena, in California, you say that you've done some research and they do only eat eggs. The rhombic egg eater only eats eggs, and you say maybe a lapwing egg. Now, a lapwing is a ground nesting bird, as you pointed out, and is it possible that it could be a lapwing egg? I think it could well be. A lapwing egg to me, though, looks a bit big. You know, that snake was small, and its throat was about that wide. So it's possible that that could be a lapwing egg, but I think a lapwing egg is a little bit large for that. So I would say it was something smaller, maybe even a robin or a weaver, little eggs. And I think that that snake, although it was on the ground, could well have collected the egg from somewhere else. We're doing another turn around here. And Ramey, I don't really know how long it will take for that snake to digest the egg, but I think once the shell is cracked, it'll disappear pretty quickly. The calcium in the egg will obviously take a little bit longer than the albumin and the yolk. Right, let's have another listen here, and we'll just watch these two virtual starlings while we're waiting. Oh, look at that. One of them's a youngster. One of them's a little one. They grow so fast, these birds. And the one, yeah, that one there is a youngster. Shorter tail than the adult. Blacker head. And it was begging. It is incredible. It's probably about a month old, maybe even less. There's a whole little family of them. I think there's a clutch of recently fledged virtual starlings. There's an adult in the tree there. It's now flying off. Let me just move around a little bit. Let's see if we can't get a nice look. I am, of course, hoping to hear the woodland kingfisher again here. I heard him call once, and then he ceased. They must have had a nest around here somewhere. We'll just go around so that Tibbs can get a proper picture of them. There we go. They're just sitting underneath the Djuma Dam cam now. I wonder if they don't have a nest around there. So they nest in tree holes. I think I've just found the nest. Tibbs, let's go around the front here. Ooh, nasty hole in the ground. Excuse me getting in the way of the Djuma Dam cam, but these things must be done every so often. I spotted a hole in the tree up there, but I don't think there is one actually. Wonderful to see these birds breeding and then developing, and it's just it's a very special time of year. There's little birds coming out all over the place and new migrants coming in every day, like that sandpiper we had today, the wood sandpiper. Let's head on. The woodland kingfisher clearly does not want to see me today, which I think is extremely selfish of it. But you know, I'm sure there'll be others. I'm very sorry to tell you that it's not a good time for your request. Susan, you said I'd show you an African bullfrog with a tooth in its mouth after the rain. Yeah, I haven't seen any now. They'll come out more at night and possibly also when there's a bit more heat in the air. Remember, they're also ectothermic, so very little heat around the place at the moment, so they'll struggle to move. So this wouldn't be a great frog time. But that said, we may be lucky. But I think the best time is going to be when it heats up a little bit, and especially when the termite alates start to fly out of the mounds. You often find bullfrogs then lurking around there. I'm just looking at a hornbill. What's this hornbill, Tibbs? He's carrying something and he's sitting on a dead tree. So Susan, I don't think bullfrogs today, but when it heats up and the termite alates start to fly, yes, definitely. Oh, he's got a nest here. No, he doesn't. Every time I see a hornbill carrying anything at the moment, I'm still watching him. I think there's... I don't know. There may be a nest in that tree. Every time you see any... back across the damn wall and then see. Very, it's not a earlier, not a very crisp morning, a really kind of heavy atmosphere. The clouds are low and they're moving at quite a speed. Come on, Kingfisher, don't let me down. Now, for those of you who perhaps don't know, many of the kingfishers, especially here, don't in fact eat fish. And the woodland kingfisher that we're looking for is one of those. So the kingfishers that we get here are the brown hooded, the malachite, the pygmy, the woodland, the striped, and the grey hooded, and the pied. And of those, only the pied, the malachite, and I think maybe the grey hooded eat fish as a matter of course. The rest of them are fairly sort of voracious eaters of just about anything that has meat in it. And they will eat. So they will eat fish if they happen to be lying around the place, but they don't hunt for fish like the malachite and the pygmy, the malachite and the pied, which hover above the water and then dive down and catch the fish. It's an amazing thing to see. But certainly a lot of them will eat frogs. And I know I've seen the woodland eating frogs. But they also will eat many insects and other kinds of protein-rich foods. Not much in the way of seed or grass insects are the kingfishers with their spear-like beaks. Wise, Djuma does tend to be a little bit on the poor side. So we don't often see monkeys, we hardly ever see baboons. The lane in Johannesburg, you'd like to know why, is the lane you've been to many reserves where baboons are. Lane, I'm not entirely sure. I think the main reason has probably got to do with the lack of roosting sites. So they do come through here every so often. But we don't have a major river running through the reserve, which means that large fig trees and big jackalberry trees, there's the odd big jackalberry, but not a huge number, those sorts of trees don't occur here. And because of that, there are not very obvious roosting sites for baboons. They could well go down to the Sand River or be closer to the Sand River or the Manuleti River, which is off to the west of us, where there are huge trees that they can roost in at night. So I suspect it's got quite a lot to do with the safety of it. I also think, though, when the jackalberries start to fruit here, that we will see the odd troop of baboons coming through. But I think they will be very transient. I don't think they're going to hang around for too long. Very nice question there, thank you. One of the, you know, of course, for many people, the concept of a creepy crawly is a ubiquitous thing that means anything that doesn't have fur on it, and it terrifies the wits out of you. And certainly, while invertebrates are very fascinating to me, the centipede, which Barbara, you're asking about, is certainly was something that gives me the heebie-jeebies, even though I've been out here for so long. A centipede, with its, I don't know, the way it moves, and it's kind of a, they do have a really pretty nasty bite. They give me the heebies too. And Barbara, we do get them here. Not that many of them, but they are around. And possibly my least favorite of the invertebrates. Scuttling about. Millipedes, of course, are very, very common, and the millipede is totally unrelated to the centipede. And they, of course, have many hundreds of legs. A centipede doesn't normally have 100 legs at all. So we're just coming down through now a drainage line, or
dry riverbed.
And what we'll do is right in front of the camp, in front of where telecamp. Tebs, if you can just kind of sweep the camera past here, I'll show you what I meant by the lack of roosting sites. So there are some tall trees here, but none of them on the scale of those big fig trees or leadwood trees or enormous jackalberries that grow on some of the drainage lines and dry riverbeds, and indeed the perennial sand river that's quite close to this area. So I think that is the major reason that we don't have resident troops of baboons here at Djuma. Wonderful sound there of the orange-breasted bushshrike. Such a lovely, peaceful sound of the morning. But this morning is not heating up. And you would find if the sun popped out, the volume of birdsong would increase exponentially. But right now it's a very kind of a calm. Well, not quite chamber music. I used the analogy of chamber music for the winter. But it's certainly not everybody in the orchestra is playing at the moment. Dave in Texas, you're a very observant fellow, obviously, and you want to know what the button is that I'm pushing behind the steering wheel every time we start the car. It is on this thing, and it's called an immobilizer, which is supposed to stop the car and stop thieves taking your car. Now, of course, there are many things about the Land Rover that are, shall we say, illogical at best and insane at worst. One of them on this particular model of the car is this immobilizer, which is wonderful if you live in a ghetto and don't want your car stolen. It's entirely pointless here at Djuma though. However, in order to remove it, apparently one has to expend the same amount of effort as one might building a new space station, taking the car apart, removing the various bits and pieces of the immobilizer, and so it's actually impossible to take out. So we just make do with it. As far as I remember, an old one, not a new one. Well, I think that's going to be it for me, everybody. Jamie is standing by to take over, and please enjoy her presentation with the kids. I think it's going to be a really fascinating time, especially hearing the interaction that will come from them. Young minds in the bush, and we have them watching our regular drives, are just a very special way to enjoy it. So thank you, Tebs, for your efforts today. Thank you to Louise, who's back in the final control. I can't remember who else is there, but all the girls are on site now. Nikki and Tara and Kirsty. Nikki is the other one doing the job at the moment. And a big thanks, of course, to Scott and Vian. And we will see you later this afternoon. Have a wonderful day or evening wherever you happen to find yourself in the world. Bye-bye.